Oh god.
What's he doing?
I don't know. What are you doing? There's enough banging there to send us all to Jesus. I'm gonna die. I wanna die comfortable. I need my kit and my cans, yeah?
What's going on down there, Eldridge?
I'm getting his kit and his cans. Cover me, please.
As played by Jeremy Renner, Staff Sergeant and Bomb Dismantler William James of the Hurt Locker is the latest macho outsider to be the focus of director Kathryn Bigelow, as well as the latest in a long, complicated legacy of cinematic outlaw anti-heroes. Why are we drawn to such alpha male leaders, both in the movies and in a world increasingly influenced by the movies?
For you.
For Bigelow, the appeal of these men lies in their ability to experience risky and dangerous missions in the same manner as an adrenaline-inducing drug.
Go!
That perverse pleasure is an immediate one for William James, a variety of religious experience perhaps, but for the audience it is most definitely mediated. The film's first shot is from the point of view of a bomb dismantling robot. As the Hurt Locker progresses, the soldiers' points of view are increasingly returned by the looks of surrounding enemies and civilians. These acts of putting oneself in another's place, often via technology, acts undertaken by both the audience and the audience's surrogates, reflect on the experience of watching movies. It's the same sort of reflection seen in Bigelow's Strange Days, in the metaphor of a virtual reality device that lets its users re-experience the most dramatic events of other people's lives. Such a device becomes a drug that can offer hits of vicarious sex and violence.
Come on, you motherfucker!
God damn it, you know I don't deal in snuff!
I don't have a fucking coroner.
Well, you could have at least warned me. You know I hate the zat. When they die, it just brings down your whole day.
Jesus. Sorry.
How'd you get the tip? How come the cops didn't put it in evidence?
I guess with all the blood, they didn't see the ring. A guy had it under a wig.
Yeah, but how'd it get to you?
I got ways, Lenny. I got ways, man. I got to deal with some of the paramedics. My guy pages me, and I pick it up at the morgue. So what do you think? This clip has got to be worth at least a grand, right?
Tick, not to dash your hopes, but I don't deal this kind of product. You know that.
We're done.
Sanborn! Let's get out of here.
In the Hurt Locker, how we see, from what distance and through what set of eyes, shapes our perception of the enigmatic and troubling character of James.
You're the guy in the flaming car, Sergeant James?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, sir. Well, that's just hot shit. You're a wild man, you know that?
Yes,
sir. He's a wild man, you know that? Why don't you shake your hand?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. How many bombs have you disarmed?
I'm not quite sure, sir.
Sergeant.
Yes.
I asked you a question.
873.
That's just hot shit. 873.
They're counting today, sir, yes.
That's got to be a record. What's the best way to go about disarming one of these things?
The way you don't die, sir.
That's a good one. That's spoken like a wild man. That's good.
Since the macho outlaw hero bears an unstable relation to death and destruction, he's often seen as a danger to the very people he's supposed to work alongside and protect.
Yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't cool.
Yeah, no, you'll get it though.
A particular scene in Bigelow's film confronts this dynamic. Setting off test explosives in the middle of the desert, James realizes he left his gloves at the bomb site. While on his way there to pick up his gear, Sergeant Sanborn, a member of James' team who does not take well to his hot dog attitude, vocally toys with the idea of detonating the explosives.
You know, these detonators misfire all the time.
What are you doing?
I'm just saying, shit happens, they misfire.
He'd be obliterated to nothing.
Soon there's a shot of James in the distance. He's found his gloves and is yelling back at his fellow sergeants like a little kid.
No, I mean, are you serious about killing him?
Since the shot of James is from Sanborn and Eldridge's point of view, the effect is comical and sinister. What would otherwise be a harmless wave encapsulates Eldridge's, and especially Sanborn's, disdain for their leader's jocular recklessness.
Sergeant James, take off your shirt.
Yes, sir.
What happened?
My mama dropped me when I was a baby.
But how do we as viewers relate to James?
Come on!
At first, James may seem remote to our understanding of so-called normal human activity.
You like that, huh?
That's all you got?
But he eventually draws closer and reveals more sides of his humanity. In his behavior toward the soldiers under his command.
Use your camo, where is it?
In his rapport with an Iraqi boy who sells bootleg DVDs to the Americans.
Is it a good one?
Yes, the best shit, man.
Okay, here you go, I'll take one.
In the strange bond he has with the job that might one day kill him.
How's it looking, Al?
Good to go.
Let's do it.
And yet, by the end of the film, James cuts himself off from the rest of the world and distances himself from us by once again becoming the ineffable symbol of outlaw bravado, a man who channels his death drive to uphold the cause of civilization. James's seeming obliviousness to the possibility of death evokes Captain Willard's assessment of Colonel Kilgore in Apocalypse Now.
He was one of those guys that had that weird light around him. You just knew he wasn't going to get so much as a scratch here.
What happened to your mission, Captain? To try and forget all about you.
Indeed, James may be an ungodly amalgam of Willard and Kilgore.
Where is it?
It's behind the wall.
You see any wires? Any smoke?
No, I didn't look.
So how do you know it's a bomb?
The car has been parked illegally. The suspension is sagging. There's definitely something heavy in the trunk.
Right. So why don't you walk over there and peek inside and tell me what you see?
You want me to go close to it?
Yeah. No, I'm kidding.
He is continually drawn back to war, where he can best put his demons to use, and also possessed by the sort of gung-ho attitude that would make one attack an enemy-occupied beach just to ride a wave.
What do you think?
Wow, it's really exciting, man.
No, the waves! The waves!
Oh, right.
Look at that, strikes both ways. Watch.
An act reminiscent of the surf or die bank robbers of Bigelow's masterpiece, Point Break.
What the fuck, you Tom? What are you thinking doing? You let him go!
No, I didn't.
James, Willard, Kilgore, and the surfers. From afar, these outlaws suggest unusual beasts. Fascinating to watch, perhaps, but lethal to encounter up close. Their air of invincibility and their communion with the sur logic of adrenaline are too much to handle for those lacking the same courage or madness.
We'll get him when he comes back in!
He's not coming back.